Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to my video diary as an education ambassador, where I give you the scoop on what's happening in education in our community every Sunday evening. I hope you had a wonderful holiday season and your new year is off to a good start. I also hope you're staying safe and healthy. Tonight, I will continue to talk to you about the District 8 Community Education Council roundtable with the Chancellor that took place on Monday, January 11th, in terms of our closing statement to the Chancellor. Yeah, we gave the Chancellor deadlines and homework. LOL. But we did. So, like I mentioned in the previous videos, in case this is the only video you're viewing, or if you're viewing them out of order, we told the Chancellor that education will not get better until parents are truly at the table. Just like the UFT, United Federation of Teachers, and the CSA, Councils of School Supervisors, right? And we told him that he needed to work on three serious areas when it comes to parent empowerment: making sure that parents have a seat at the table of governance, making sure that parents and parent leadership groups are collaborating with one another, and also improving access for parents in the categories of language, information, communication, technology, and assistance when in crisis. So, in this video, we are going to discuss our closing statement to the Chancellor. So, in our closing statement, we told the Chancellor that basically, in the last couple of years, we have been talking about reimagining schools, right? Or maybe it's more than 2 years. So, we submitted to the Chancellor that we must reimagine schools, the DOE, and the roles of all the education stakeholders. Most importantly, we must reimagine the roles of parents and communities in education. In the reimagining of education in NYC, in New York City, the partnership should not be among just parents and teachers. It ought to be a collaboration of all the stakeholders at every level of the bureaucracy and at every level of education underground. We also told him that, unfortunately, in public education in the United States right now, education systems across the nation are being asked to do the work that our different levels of government have failed to do, which is to invest in education in underserved, under-resourced communities at the same time. Because the two go together, right? You don't have improvement in education if you don't have improvement in the socioeconomic status of communities, right? In fact, they fuel each other, right? So, in reality, what we are doing as a nation, which is truly unfair, right? We are asking schools to solve the problems of poverty, legalized inequity, and injustice based on race, class, and immigration status. We are also lying to the public by pretending that educators alone can somehow solve all the ills of society with their magic wand, which we know they don't have. And on top of that, we are disrespecting our children, our education professionals, our parents, and our communities by pretending to be pouring resources in schools that we know are inadequate, while expecting these schools to perform well and have had the audacity, right? And in some cases continue to have the audacity to punish them when they don't. So we told the Chancellor that the moment of reckoning that we are experiencing as a nation is also in education. The Chancellor alone, we told him, cannot solve this problem. But he can enlist for the chancellorship, meaning the next chancellor that will come after him, and the next one, and the next one. He can enlist for the chancellorship an army of empowered parents who can lead this fight for equity at the highest levels where it will be truly solved. The truth is, the problem of education cannot be solved through A, layers of bureaucracy that just make the system ineffective, B, a bunch of endless meetings with parents and other stakeholders that go nowhere because these people are not really at the table of governance, and C, a constant flow of badly spent funds to the top and big contracts to continue to enrich the rich, while at the same time, A, disinvesting in schools, students, and the communities on the ground, and B, engaging in the superficial empowerment of our parents. We let the chancellor know that that our parents and our students are smart enough to know that real and sustained change lies in policy and systemic changes, which would empower parents as part of the solution. Because at the end of the day, individuals, families, communities, they have to help themselves. Yes, we can accept help from government, help from the private sector, help from wherever we can get it. But at the end of the day, the biggest help is the help we give to ourselves. So we asked the chancellor, after telling him all of that, to reconvene with us in a few weeks to see what he was able to accomplish in terms of our suggestions. And, you know, being the good people that we are, because we don't like to just complain and not give solutions, we also offered our help. Like, you know, chancellor, if you need us, and I'm telling the chancellor this again today, if he needs our help to make these things happen, the District 8 Community Education Council and the District 8 President's Council, we are able, we are willing to help make it happen for our parents, for our students, and our schools. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this brings me to the end of my video diary series for this weekend about our roundtable with the chancellor. I hope the videos gave you a few things to think about in terms of what your demands to the DOE ought to be when you are advocating for yourselves, your children, your schools, and your community. If you want to see the actual video of the roundtable, please visit. I hope you can see this, right? I don't know if you can see it, but let me try to make it bigger. But anyway, you'll get it. It's so visit this site. I will put it on a paper so that we can put it in the video so you can see. And if you want the actual transcript, please visit the District 8 website next month when we will have it up. Next week, we will discuss our CEC 8 letters to the Biden transition team. By then, I suppose Biden will be our president. And our letter to former President Obama, whom we used to, nag all the time on behalf of education. So we'll discuss those letters and how President-elect Biden, and the Secretary of Education to be Miguel Cardona reacted to our letter. And, I guess this is it. So have a great week and see you next time for another episode of My Video Diary, where I give you the scoop of what's happening in education in our community every Sunday evening. Bye, and stay safe. See you. Lord.